renounce Jesus Christ. And then he got talking with his jailer, and the jailer had a daughter who was blind, apparently. And this is apparently, I'm saying here, because I'm not sure. But they started exchanging letters. She was healed of her blindness, you know, prior to the fact, I guess, of when Valentine was executed. But the part I want you to remember, of course, is that part where he would not renounce Jesus. Why was he in prison in the first place, Valentine? You know, because in that pagan society there, you know, you had to bow down to Caesar. And he, of course, would not do that and would only proclaim the crucified Jesus Christ. And so that is really the importance, I think, of that story. If that story is exactly correct, I'm not sure, but it kind of sounds good. And it tells us something, too, about our testimony and what our witness needs to be as well. And thankfully, in this country here, we can freely, you know, share the name of Jesus. So please keep that in heart and mind here. And it's that love of Christ himself, that love of Jesus, you know, which empowered Valentine and empowers you and me as well. Let us pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank you for that love and that love and grace that comes through Jesus Christ, the God who is the one all glorified and honored. And so as we worship here this morning, may we also learn and therefore proclaim that name of Jesus to the world. Bless our time together. May we sing songs of joy, and may we continue to be built up in that one true faith in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer. And so thank you, for dear Lord, for the love that you pour out, and may we continue to grow in your living and loving presence now and forevermore. Amen. Appropriately, we begin our worship singing Beautiful Savior.
Lord of the
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
O God, our Father, we admit and confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed.
Have mercy on us and forgive us, O Lord.
We confess that we have not always brought glory to you through our words and our deeds. We repent of all that is sinful in our lives, both that which we know and those things unknown to us that are against your righteous laws.
Have mercy on us and forgive us, O Lord.
Upon this, your confession, and by the command of our Lord, I, a called and ordained servant of Christ, forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And let us pray. God of grace and glory, before your Son turned his face to Jerusalem and Mount Calvary, on another mountain you revealed his glory as he appeared with Moses and Elijah. Sustain your church both by his glory and also by your grace, and help us to reflect the glory of your love to all. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we listen to the Word of God.
Sorry. When they have crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I can do for you before I am taken from you." "Let me inherit a double portion of your spirit," Elisha replied. "You have asked a difficult thing," Elijah said. "Yet if you see me when I am taken from you, it will be yours. Otherwise, it will not." As they walked along and talked together, suddenly a chariot of fire, of horses and fire, appeared and separated the two of them. Elijah went up to heaven in a whirlwind. Elisha saw this and cried out, "My father, my father, the chariots and the horsemen of Israel." Elisha saw him no more. Then he took hold of his garment and tore it in two. This is the word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning. Today's reading is from 2 Corinthians chapters 3 and 4. Paul writes, "Therefore, since we have such a hope, we are very bold. We are not like Moses, who would put on a veil over his face to prevent the Israelites from seeing the end of what was passing away. Therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we preach is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as our servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 9th chapter. Six days after the events of Caesarea Philippi, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say. They were so frightened. Then a cloud appeared and covered them, and a voice came from the cloud, "This is my son whom I love. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man has risen from the dead. This is the Gospel of the Lord. In the name of God, Father, God, Son, and God, Holy Spirit, all honor, praise, glory, majesty due to their holy name. Amen. A couple summers ago, my wife and I took our grandchildren to New Hampshire, and we went to Mount Washington there. And we took the cog railway up the side of the mountain. Now, you can drive up, which is like crazy to do, but we took this very slow rail up the top of Mount Washington. Down in the valley, it was probably 80 degrees. But then you slowly climb and you get above the tree line and you get higher and higher and higher until you get to the top of the mount there, which is probably about 6,600 feet high. And you get out and it's just a magnificent sight. You know, thankfully, we had a very clear day. I think the temperature was about 52, I think, at the top of the mountain on that particular day. But you could see, it seemed forever. It's beautiful. It really is. I think you can see like five states in Canada on a clear day. It's just a wonderful, wonderful sight. The kids were all running around and taking pictures and just marveling at the beauty there. And then, of course, after a couple of hours, we had to get back on that cog railway and go back down into the valley again. It was thrilling to be there. And that's, I think, what Peter James and John felt as well. They went with Jesus on top of a mountain as well, and it was an awesome sight which they saw too. They're probably at Mount Hermon, which is just above Sea of Galilee, and that's about 9,900 feet high. So it's pretty high. In fact, there's even, you know, snow up on the peaks there during certain times of year. And they probably didn't go all the way up 9,900 feet and walked up there. They certainly didn't have a railway. And yet they went up quite a distance. And it was at that time that Jesus was transfigured before those disciples. Now, to be transfigured, easily defined, is that you are changed. But it's a lot more than just change there. He was metamorphosized, really. That's where we get our word metamorphosis from. It was kind of like, you know, going from a caterpillar to a butterfly, you know, that kind of a change, that awesome change. In this case, Jesus just radiated. And notice I said radiated with light. He didn't reflect light. He radiated light. It came from him so that his clothes were dazzling white, so that you couldn't even bleach them, you know, so much. Yet here is that appearance that Jesus had before those disciples in that glorious, majestic way. And there with Jesus suddenly appeared Moses and Elijah. That's important. It's important because Moses represents the commandments, right? The law of God, the Ten Commandments. When Moses was up on another mountain, Sinai, received those rules, if you will, from God himself. And Elijah, well, he's the greatest of the prophets, they say. Here was one who was great in terms of his prophecy, which would be fulfilled. And Jesus would fulfill not just all the law perfectly, but all those prophecies that were made. Jesus would fulfill those as well. So Moses and Elijah, yeah. Very appropriate that they were there as well. Of course, Peter's response, you heard clearly. He didn't want to leave. He wanted to stay on top of the mountain. It was a mountaintop experience. It was an awesome presence. Why should we go? Let's build three shelters for you, Jesus, for you, for Moses, for Elijah, and we'll just stick around. We will just stay there with you because this is just wonderful. We just want to bask in your glory here. And so we'll make these lean-tos or dwellings or whatever, and we will stick around here and just enjoy ourselves. Why go back down into the valley? But of course, Peter, he had it kind of backwards. It's not that, you know, we make tents for Jesus. He's the one who really dwells inside of us. And that is quite significant. He's the one who bivouacs with you. He's the one who comes to you. He sets up his tent within you, within your heart. He is part of your life in that way. He made that move so that he would live with you now and always. No matter what kind of trials, what kind of circumstances you are going through, yet Jesus dwells here. That is the one true faith. Yeah, it's a little hard, and it is certainly hard, we sinners, to kind of get that, to believe it constantly. You know, it's normally, yeah, I got to do it my way. I mean, that's really the way we think so often. You know, I really have the right approach and ideas and so forth and make the decisions kind of my way. And so kind of Jesus is put in the back burner. And especially during difficult times and struggles that you go through, whether it be the pandemic and this ripple effect that takes place because of it, or whether it's because of some other problem or issue that you have, you know, we still want to deal with it ourselves too much. We really kind of doubt God's presence and his care to take care of us and to really guide us during those harder moments when we're kind of down, you know, we're kind of depressed. We don't like what we see there. You know, we like the high experience, you know, like when there's a birthday party or an anniversary or a vacation. We don't want to leave there. We don't want to get away from family. You know, we like that presence, but we know, you know, tomorrow it's a different day and it's going to be a struggle. We're kind of like the tourist that was driving in the Smoky Mountains. going from North Carolina over to Tennessee. And I don't know if you've been there. I have had the pleasure. Beautiful, absolutely gorgeous. You know, you're driving through the mountains there, and then there's another mountain there, and wow, it's just totally green and picturesque and all. But there was this vacationer, this tourist, who wanted to take the slow route around himself, wanted to look at it from every different angle and be part of the view. And so he's in Smoky Mountains, and he gets climbing to the highest of the peaks there as well. And I mean, it's just gorgeous. It's just wonderful. And of course, he didn't want to leave at all. But then, 5 o'clock, you know, sun is starting to go down here. I guess I better get going. And he looks at his gas tank and notice the dial is on E. How is he going to get to the other side? He's only halfway through the mountains there, and he's got to get over to Tennessee before he can get gasoline, he believes. And so he kind of slowly, you know, kind of glides down the hill. And then when he sees another hill in front of him, like, oh, how am I going to make it? Am I going to make it? So he's in a panic. Thankfully, he sees this rusty old sign and gas pump on the side of the road. He pulls in. And there's that mountain man there, you know, with a big beard, you know, and he's whittling away right there in his rocking chair. And he gets out of his rocking chair, this guy, and this mountain man, he starts actually putting gas into his car. Thankfully, you know, it looks like he's going to make it. He strikes up a conversation with his mountain man saying, how do you live here? I mean, like there's nothing around. You know, how do you survive here out in the wilderness? It's beautiful, it is, but how do you survive? And the old mountain man says, well, I just charge $19.80 per gallon of gasoline, and I do just fine. But we're kind of there in the same place. You know, we're there, and we love the experience, but we don't realize that, yeah, we're running out of fuel. I mean, I felt that way during these last months. You know, it's hard just getting to the next day. You know, am I going to make it sometimes? And really, you need to be refreshed and to refilled in that way. And yeah, you know, you can talk about faith and everything and fine, but you know, the law of God, you know, really points to our sin and our emptiness really there and how we do have doubts. And we realize that, yeah, I climb one hill and then I go around the turn and there's another hill. And that's difficult to climb. And I got to do it again and again and again. You know, when's this turmoil going to end at all? And yes, we can know about the radiation that God exudes in terms of his light, because he's the light of the world, but still there's the struggle and there's the hurt that is there. Yeah, Jesus is the one, though, who fills that. He is the one who is there, knowing the twists and turns in our lives, knowing that, yeah, you know, I'm kind of downcast. You know, I don't know what's going on tomorrow. And yet, this lesson says that Jesus is there. And we need someone. You need someone who cares about where you're at in life. You need someone who can give you guidance and help when you are struggling, not knowing which way to turn. You know, you need someone who will give to you his presence to be part of your life, realizing that you don't do this alone. You do it with the glory of God that is there with you. You see, Jesus, he'll go down that valley, into that valley with those disciples. And that's an important part of this gospel lesson here. Notice, they go back down together. They go into the valley, those times which are a struggle, those times which are trials, into the valley of the shadow of death. You know, Jesus goes with you. He goes with those disciples. Know what's going to be before them, what they're going to have to get through during the coming days. He goes with them, and he does the same for us. And he takes on our sin, takes on our doubts, takes on the anxieties of this world, takes them upon himself, and then he climbs a mountain. Jesus does. He climbs Mount Calvary by himself. He dies on that cross for your sins. You have forgiveness of your sins. There is God's grace which is poured out for you, saying, hey, that's how much I love you. That's how much I care about you. And that's not a Valentine's love. No, it's much, much more than a Valentine's love, believe it or not, because this is a love that is totally unconditional, perfectly forgiving. It is all of that because it comes from a perfect God, a God who loves you above all. He loves you in your circumstance and what you're going through and pours out his love to you when he gives his life on the cross. And then, on that third day, it's like a transfiguration, right? Here Jesus, who was so weak and frail on that cross, dying with his last breath, and then on Easter Sunday, oh, the transformation, brilliant light. He bursts from the tomb. He is there with his disciples. Yeah, that's what transfiguration is trying to say as well. That the mission that you and I have in our Christian body here, the church, that mission really is the mission of the church to bring that glorious, magnificent Christ to people who are suffering. It comes to people who are in hurt and in pain. That's what the mission is all about. And all of us, at one point or another, are there in that circumstance and situation. That is why this Transfiguration Sunday is where it is in the church year. It's not haphazard, you know, just to throw it on a particular Sunday in normally February. Notice that Transfiguration Sunday is halfway between the birth of Jesus and the resurrection of Jesus. It's like right in the middle. It serves as a transition, really. A transition from this day, which is an apex, you know, of the Epiphany season, to what starts happening on Wednesday, Ash Wednesday. And now we have this high, and now, yeah, there's this kind of valley there during Lent. It's a more somber season, a repentant season. And therefore, we are there now with Christ as he suffers in his passion. We recognize our sinful state. And so, yeah, it's purposely put here this Transfiguration Sunday. Peter, well, the impetuous Peter, you know, with his tents, you know, and dwellings and so forth there, and wanting to stay, you know, up in the mountain. It's good, Lord, to be here, he says. He gets it after a while. He doesn't get it then, but he gets it after a while. And you know that because of that lesson that's at the beginning of your bulletin, really, from 2 Peter. Notice what he says in 2 Peter. He is now testifying to the incarnate deity of Jesus himself. And he says, in words that are not there, but he says prior to it, he says, we didn't make up clever myths at all. No, we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. We were there with him on the mountain and saw that glory. He references the transfiguration in his letter of 2 Peter. And so Peter gets it after a while. He proclaims it with all boldness. And that is what we are to be doing as well, doing the same. And yet there's two more brief points to make here. The first one is this. You've been transfigured. When? At your baptism. That's when you were changed. Christ is in you. You are in Christ. It starts at your baptism. During that sacrament, it begins. And so we have that nearness of Christ right there as he is part of our lives. Or as I like the way it is said in the great hymn, the battle hymn of the Republic. And if you think of the battle hymn of the Republic, you may not remember these words, but I think it's in the second verse, not sure, but it says there, with a glory in his bosom, he transfigures you and me. And those words to me are very powerful in that very mighty hymn. And so we are transfigured, we are changed individuals as well unto his glory. And then the second point is this, and that is right at the end, where the voice from heaven comes down and says, this is my son in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. Those words the same words at Jesus' baptism. The same words as Jesus' baptism. Here they're repeated by the Father as his voice comes down from heaven. Listen to him. And that's what you and I are to be doing. Listening to our Lord as we read the word, as we hear the word, as we meditate on the word of God, and then act accordingly as we listen to that word. Because that word speaks about the glory, the majesty of God in our lives. The God who cares, the God who is there during your trials, the times when you need guidance, that Jesus Christ is there too. So that you are prepared. When you are in that valley, you are going through different kinds of tribulation, you know that God's presence is there now with you. Until that time when you fully realized his glory in everlasting life. Amen. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we pray for great faith. May we see your glory. We know of your presence in the Holy Sacrament, in bread and wine. May your presence be within us, and may that visibly be shown to others. But uplift us, strengthen us, dear Lord, that we might see you, the God of all majesty and glory, to whom honor and praise is due, in Jesus Christ, Savior, Redeemer, and King. Amen. May we stand and make a proclamation of our faith. In that unity, in that confidence, we say together, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people who are in need. For the gospel proclaimed in word and deed, for communities of faith far and near, and for all who show the face of Christ throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy, for creation, sun, moon, and stars, life forming in the dark earth and ocean deep, mountains, clouds, and storms, and creatures seen and unseen, and for the Holy Spirit's guidance in our stewardship of God's creation, Lord, in your mercy, for those responsible for safety and protection, for emergency responders and security guards, attorneys and advocates, civil servants and leaders of government, that they witness to mercy and justice throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy, for companions on life's journey in this worshiping community, for loved ones who cannot be with us this day, and for guidance during struggles we face, that God's glory is revealed around and among us. Lord, in your mercy, for all who suffer this day, especially Lucy Green, who's been diagnosed with Parkinson's disease, for continued prayers of healing for Dee, Barbara, Kerry, Gloria, who are being treated for cancer issues. And we continue to pray words of healing for Bridget, for Joe, for Laura, Susan, Andrew, Chris, Alex, Christina. And in our prayers now, we mention those publicly or privately who are seeking God's healing presence. We thank you, dear Lord, that your presence is with them. Build up their faith. Grant them peace as well as your healing touch. And that Christ, our healer, transforms sickness into health, loneliness into companionship, bereavement into consolation, and suffering into peace. Lord, in your mercy, in thanksgiving, we pray for faithfully departed who now rest from their earthly pilgrimage, that their lives of service and prayer inspire us in our living. Lord, in your mercy, and in our prayers is this body of Christ, Emmanuel Lutheran Church and School. Grant patience, dear Lord, during this time of waiting now, as we await potentially names of individuals who might be the shepherd here at Emmanuel Lutheran. And so may we wait with that sense of confidence, knowing that you will faithfully provide for the servants here of Emmanuel and throughout this community. Lord, in your mercy, merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated for a brief announcement, or 10.
Hello again. It's on this time, right? A couple announcements. Just remember that, as we mentioned, Lenten season starts with Ash Wednesday. This week we have service at 6:30. Also, we wanted to thank George for all the work he's been doing and his helpers. With all this, taking care of the parking lot and snow that we seem to be getting hit with every single day these days, in this coming week, right? Thank you.
Thank you, George, and Larry too. Larry's out there. Thank you. Yeah, please say hello to them. You know, they do some work and they do it inexpensively too. Really saves a dollar to me. Anyway, thank you. Also, just a word about Ash Wednesday, if I might. This Wednesday, that penitential season begins. And you might be a little concerned about that. You are certainly invited to be here. We are going to have the imposition of ashes, just so that you know. That will be taking place here. Going to do it slightly different, and that is be doing it with like Q-tips or swabs. Each person gets their own, is what will happen. And so you don't have to come up for ashes. Just come, confess your sins, hear God's forgiveness through Jesus Christ. That is perfectly, perfectly fine. But we will be doing the imposition of ashes here and doing it from a distance and being precautionary as well. So please avail yourself of that. Fat Tuesday has got to lead into Ash Wednesday here, so please come this Wednesday. That's at 6:30, I believe, Wednesday evening, right here at Emmanuel. At this time, you may bring your offerings to the corners of the church or the back of the church, your thank offerings, then we'll stand and sing the offertory together. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, maker of all things. Through your goodness you have blessed us with these gifts. With them we offer ourselves to your service and dedicate our lives to the care and redemption of all that you have made, for the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord. Sharing our life, he lived among us to reveal your glory and love, that our darkness should give way to his own brilliant light. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. And do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and all people for the forgiveness of your sin. As often as you drink this, do this in remembrance of me."
Thank you.
May we stand. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. The Lord be with you. And let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you having fed us with the body and blood of our Savior Jesus Christ, assuring us thereby that we are truly members of his body, the Church, which is our fellowship of faith. By your Holy Spirit, help us to live in faith and fellowship and do the good works that you desire us to do as your witnesses in our time. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, to whom with you in the same Spirit be all honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace.
Amen.
Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord.